the splendor of the King, cloaked in majesty. Let all the earth rejoice, all the earth rejoice. He wraps himself in light, and darkness tries to hide. It trembles at his voice, trembles at his voice. How great is our God? Sing it with me. How great is our God? And all will see how great, how great. God. Let's sing that chorus again. How great is our God. Sing it with me. How great is our God. And all will see how great, how great. To age he stands, oh, and time is in his hands, beginning and the end, beginning and the end. Oh, the Lord our God is one. Oh, Father, Spirit, Son, the Lion. How great is our God? Oh, sing it with me. How great is our God? And all will see how great, how great is our God. Oh, once again, how great is our God? Sing it with me, how great is our God, and all will see how great is our God. Come on, his name, oh, name above all names, oh, worthy of all praise. So my heart will sing, how great is our God. Oh, his name above all names, oh, and he's worthy of all praise. Oh, my heart will sing, how great is our God. Oh, how great is our God. Sing it with me, how great is our God. And all will see how great, how great is our God. Oh, how great is our God. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Oh, blessed be to the name of the Lord. Hallelujah, amen. Come on, God, you are good, amen. Well, Lord, you are good, and your mercy endureth forever. Lord, you are good, and your love endureth forever. Now people from every nation and tongue, from generation to generation, we worship you. Hallelujah, hallelujah, we worship you for who you are. We worship you. Hallelujah, hallelujah, we worship you for who you are. You are good all the time, all the time. You are good, you are good all the time, all the time. You are good. Lord, you are good and your mercy endureth forever. Lord, you are good and your mercy endureth forever. Oh, there's people from every nation and tongue, from generation to generation, we worship you. Hallelujah, hallelujah, we worship you for who you are. We worship you. Hallelujah, hallelujah, we worship you for who you are. 'Cause you are good all the time, all the time. You are good, you are good all the time, all the time. You are good, oh, you are good all the time, all the time. You are good, I know you are good all the time, all the time. You are good, I know the Lord is good, hallelujah. Oh, hallelujah, hallelujah. He is so good, amen. Oh, he's no one higher. Our Father, Creator, you hold our hearts together. There's no one higher than you. Redeemer, Defender, our great and mighty Savior. There's no one higher than you. You are always with us, gracious to forgive us. By your power we've been set free. And Lord, we stand amazed in your presence, astounded by your mercy and love. Oh, our hands are lifted high in surrender, and your grace for me is always enough. Oh, now there is no one higher than our God. There is no one greater than you. Oh, let my life forever praise the glory of your name. There is no one higher than you. Majestic in wonder, majestic in wonder, you reign with love forever. There's no one higher than you. No one higher than you. Your beauty, your splendor, your glory knows no measure. There's no one higher than you. Hallelujah. You're always, you're always with us, gracious to forgive us. By your power we've been set free. That's right. Well, Lord, we stand amazed in your presence. We're astounded by your mercy and love. Oh, our hands are lifted high in surrender. Oh, and your grace, Thank you, God, for your grace. It's always enough. And there is no one higher than our God. There is no one, no one greater than you. Let my life forever praise the glory of your name. That's right, there is no one higher than you. Come on, let's do the bridge. There's no one higher than the God that we serve. Hallelujah. There's no one higher, no one great, no one like our God. There is none more able, our Savior, great and glorious. There is no one higher, no one great, no one like our God. There is none more, Christ our Savior, great and, come on, once again. There is no one high, no one great, no one like our God. There is none more able, no, our Savior, great and glorious. There is no one higher, no one greater, no one like our God. There is none more able, Christ our Savior, great and glorious. You are always with us, gracious to forgive us. By your power we've been set free. Oh Lord, we stand amazed in your presence and astounded by your mercy and love. Oh, our hands are lifted high in surrender. Oh, your grace is always enough. Oh, and there is no one higher than our God. Oh, there is no one greater than you. Oh, let my life forever praise the glory of your name. There is no one higher than you. There is no one higher. Hallelujah! Praise the name of the Lord. In Jesus' name, amen. Why don't you just reach over to somebody right now, and would you pray for them right now? Let's ask God, that high God, to touch everyone in this place. Oh, there's no one like him. Amen. There's no one higher. Come on, no one higher than our God. Amen. Come on, call upon the name of the Lord right now, and let's just have confidence in what he can do. Hallelujah. Come on, there's nobody like our Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. You're always with us. You're gracious, Lord God, in the name of Jesus. Oh, your grace is sufficient for this hour that we live in. Hallelujah. Oh, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. There's no one like our God. Hallelujah. No one like our God, in Jesus' name. Oh, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus, for your word and for your spirit. Amen. Thank you, Lord. Oh, hallelujah, Jesus. That's it, Lord God. Pour out your spirit today, Lord God. Let wisdom come forth, Lord God. Let knowledge of the Lord come forth. Oh, that's right, Lord God. Let the anointing that breaks every yoke come into this place right now, Lord God. Let no one be the same, Lord God, because of your presence. Oh, hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus, for what you do for us. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. Praise God. Take a couple of minutes this morning and walk around and shake a few hands and tell folks, that you're glad you're in the house of the Lord. In Jesus' name, amen, amen. I will enter his gates with thanksgiving in mind. I will enter his courts with praise. This is the day that the Lord has made, and I will rejoice, for he has made me glad. He has made me glad. I know that he has made me glad, and I rejoice, for he has made me glad. He has made me glad. He has always made me glad. I will rejoice, for he has made me glad. I will enter his gates with thanksgiving in my heart. I will enter his courts with praise. This is the day that the Lord has made, and I will rejoice, for he has made me glad. He has made me glad. I know he has made me glad. And I will rejoice, for he has made me glad. He has made me glad. He has always made me glad. And I will rejoice, for he has made me glad. Oh, I'm so glad the Lord saved me. Oh, I'm so glad the Lord saved me. Then for Jesus, where would I be? I'm so glad the Lord saved me. Oh, I'm so glad the Lord saved me. I'm so glad that the Lord saved me. If it hadn't been for Jesus, where would I be? I'm so glad the Lord saved me. It's glory, glory, hallelujah. Since I've laid my burdens down, it's glory, glory, every day, hallelujah. Since I've laid my burdens down, it's glory, glory, hallelujah. Since I've laid my burdens down, it's glory, glory, every day, hallelujah. Since I've laid my burdens down, it's glory, glory, every day, hallelujah. Since I've laid burdens down, it's glory, glory, amen, hallelujah. Since I've laid my burdens down, oh, it's glory, glory, hallelujah. Since I've laid my burdens down, it's glory, glory, hallelujah. Since I've laid my burdens down, you know that Jesus is on the main line. Tell him what you want. Oh, Jesus on the main line. Tell him what you want. Jesus on the main line. Tell him what you want. Come on, what do you need from the Lord? Oh, that's right. He's on the main line. Jesus on the main line. Tell him what you want. Jesus on the main line. Tell him what you want. Jesus on the main line. Tell him what you want. Cause Jesus on the main. Come on, if you want the Holy Ghost, tell him. If you want the Holy Ghost, tell him what you want. If you want the Holy Ghost, tell him what you want. Well, if you want the Holy Ghost, just tell him what you want. Jesus on the main line. Oh, if you need a healing, if you want a healing, tell him what you want. Oh, if you need a healing, tell him what you want. If you need a healing, come on, the healer is in the house. Oh, Jesus on the main line now. What do you say? Let's call him up. Call him up. Tell him what you want. Call him up, call him up. tell him what you want. Call him up, and tell him what you want. Jesus on the main line now. One more time now, Jesus on the main line. Tell him what you want. Jesus on the main line, tell him what you want. Jesus on the main line now, tell him what you want. Jesus on the main line now. Oh, do you believe that? Hallelujah! Come on, the Lord is on the main line. Hallelujah! Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Praise God. He is on the main line. Praise God. He's on the main line in Jesus' name. You can be seated. The Lord bless you this morning. Praise God. So glad that we know that Jesus is on the main line. Praise God. What an awesome, awesome God that we serve. Praise God. Awesome. Amen. And so I'm glad this morning. I came from a small town in Iowa, and back when I was growing up in the late 50s and early 60s, we had party lines. Now, some of you aren't going to, I mean, when I feel like how far we've come in these things, and in that small town, they still own their own telephone company. City of Cascade owns the telephone company. So if you got any problems with your phones in Cascade, you got to take it to them. But for years, I mean, you know, you had party lines. This is what it was. You had to share a line with, and if you were lucky, with just one other person. There were up to 4 to 6 people that shared a line. Now, they've come a long way. And I know you guys are looking at me like, this guy's got to be related to Andy Griffith. He was my uncle. No, he wasn't. But nevertheless, I'm glad today that we can reach the Lord anytime, any place. I mean to tell you, He is on the main line, praise God. Prayer is one of those things that God gives to you and I so that we can get a hold of Him. And learning how to pray, you know, and all that business is, in my opinion, a lifelong ambition. Amen. It's one of those things where I've never felt like I've arrived. I just want to get better at it. I want to do it more. I want to have more confidence in the things that God is doing. And so the fact of the matter is, you can get a hold of God. You can. The thing that God will deal with us about, on the most part, is with our needs. God knows what we need. And that's where sometimes we stumble a little bit, because we have a tendency on sometimes to get the cart before the horse. You know, it's not that God doesn't want to give us some things, but He would rather build up a vessel within you that could contain the things that He gives you. That's really what it comes down to. And so last week we talked about, on Sunday morning, we talked about that a lot of the kingdom of God can surround around the idea of building and battling. That's what it is. You know, God is building things up in us. And never forget that. You know, sometimes we get looking at it, the project, and we think, boy, you know, I don't know if this is ever going to get done. Yes, it will. It will. My opinion, you know, well, we don't have time in this world. You know, you study the 5th chapter of the book of Genesis, and it doesn't take, you know, a whole lot of intellect to realize that those guys lived a long time. You know, how would you like to live 600, 700, 800 years? Where do you think you would be at with that kind of experience? You'd be ways ahead, wouldn't you? You'd seen a lot of things. You probably couldn't count the amount of cycles that came your way. And you begin to see things. Time has a way of giving us that type of perspective, praise God. But you and I are not living in that age. Since the day of the flood, the 6th chapter of the book of Genesis brought about a tremendous change to this world. I don't have it all figured out. I'm not a scientist, that type of thing. But I do know that the world that was then changed considerably. I know you've probably heard some scientific reports, and they could be true. I don't know where the earth was put on its axis, and seasons begin to come into play, and there's scripture that supports that. I mean, we don't really know exactly how the world was prior to that, because we weren't there. We did have very, very limited resources. The scripture doesn't give us a lot of understanding.
But we know that our world became different. And immediately after that, people didn't live as long. They just didn't. I mean, they lived longer than we know, but the bottom line is that it seems like it's been decreasing and that type of thing. Point I'm making is that you and I don't have enough time. We don't have enough time to develop all of the things of God. And so God mainlines these things to us via his Spirit. That's what makes the New Testament so far, far ahead of the Old Testament, in my opinion. It's not that we do away with the Old Testament. The fact of the matter is we can learn a lot from the Old Testament. Amen. Just the study of creation can help you to understand a lot of different things. It really can. Praise God. You study those first two chapters, and I mean to tell you, you're going to find some cool things that are involved. Let me give you an example of this, okay? Let me show you something here. The second chapter of the book of Genesis, and this has to do, of course, with after the creation or the recreation, as I would probably put it. You know, there's no question about it. The earth was void and dark, and there were some situations that were happening down here. And so God came down, and he began to create the world as you and I know it, you know, at this point in time. And there were some cool things that happened. But let me show you what the Lord did. The Bible says in verse number 6, I'm in the second chapter of Genesis, and I wanted to show you a couple of things here about the creation or about God's creation that maybe will help you. The Bible says, "But there went up a mist from the earth and watered the whole face of the ground." That's where we get the idea that the earth was somewhat of a kind of a giant terrarium, you know. I have one in my yard, and at night it'll go on, and it's a sprinkler system. And even as bad as I like it myself, is the heat of the summer and that type of thing that goes on, you know, because I have a sprinkling system in my yard, you know, it keeps the yard green, you know. You know, I don't like cutting grass, so why do I even have it, you know? But I, you know, it's another one of those things I haven't been able to figure out for years. You know, we fertilize the lawn and then we water it so it'll grow, so you have to cut it. Something about that equation, it just doesn't make sense to me at my age, but it is what it is. And so you understand what I'm saying. Things are able to grow because of watering systems. You know, they've taken great chunks of real estate in desert places and brought in irrigation. And I mean to tell you, it makes all the difference in the world. It really does. And so we can understand that the creation that God had made was kind of like that. That there was a giant watering system. There were fountains of the deep that were able to water. And some scientists, Christian scientists, believe that the atmosphere was different and all of that. I won't go into that because I really don't have a lot of scripture for it. And it's good things to think about, but I don't know, you know, if it's really going to matter too much when it's all said and done. But the bottom line is we see an atmosphere that was created here. And the Bible says in verse number 7, the Lord formed the man of the dust of the ground and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and man became a living soul. Eternity began. Praise God. And that's what we see. That's what makes it different from us than the animal kingdom. God gave us that ability, praise God, to live forever. You know, the mercy of God comes in later on when God didn't want us to live forever in a certain state. Amen. That's one of the reasons why death came into the picture, is because, you know, there has to be something that separates, and of course that's our flesh that separates. Amen. But the Bible says in verse number 8, the Lord God planted a garden eastward in Eden, and there he put the man whom he had formed. God created an atmosphere and a place for man to dwell. This is what we see. Amen. You got to understand, God doesn't get the cart before the horse. He will create the environment, then he places mankind into that environment. Amen. And man wasn't responsible for what God did, but he was responsible for what he did in that environment. That's kind of the way it is in the New Testament today. God, you know, through his Spirit, has created a spiritual environment. That's what many of you have been able to break through into, even in this service here this morning. Amen. Into the spiritual environment that God has. And no, we can't see it in the flesh. We can't see it in our physical realm. But we know it's here. How many can identify with that? Yeah, it's here. Praise God. And that environment, praise God, brings all kinds of possibilities, healings and deliverances and salvation. I mean, anything, All things are possible in God's environment. I want you to understand that. Just like in this environment in the book of Genesis, Adam didn't do anything to bring anything into the picture. It wasn't his ability that brought this stuff into it. And this is where you and I have to keep in remembrance. You know, we don't bring a whole lot of abilities into the kingdom of God. God brings all of these things in. What you and I, what our responsibility is not only to see them, but to receive them. And then walk in those environments and rejoice in Christ Jesus. Don't let the bad environments, outweigh the good environment that God has brought into the picture. Literally, that's what he has done. Do you realize that any person can get saved now in this environment? Amen. Anybody can come close to God and live a very close, productive life in Jesus Christ. That's what that kind of an environment brought. Oh, I'm telling you something, folks. I'm excited about that. And I got to keep remembering, I didn't do anything to do this. This is all God's idea. Amen. And that's why it's important for us to realize that the invitation is an open invitation. What was it that John, the Gospel of John says? God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son. He makes that open invitation to any and everybody. You can come into an environment, and you got to understand, I don't think, the whole world was included here. He'd made a garden, a special place, praise God, for his son, Adam, to dwell, praise God. Now watch this. The scripture says, and out of the ground, in verse number 9, we're still in Genesis chapter number 2. I love the story of creation. It says, and out of the ground made the Lord God to grow every tree that is pleasant to the sight. And it says, and good for food, the tree of life also in the midst of the garden, and the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. God put all of this stuff in that environment, praise God. And then the scripture tells us, and a river. Look at somebody and say, a river. Amen. Rivers are important, praise God. That's what brings a lot of times life into a certain area, praise God. You can go into river valleys and the soil will be much richer and things can grow there, and it just seems like that's quite an environment, that type of thing. And that's why over the years, people sometimes find themselves in those places because of what happens there. And so the Bible says that a river went out of Eden to water the garden. Do you see that? And from thence it was parted and became into four heads. Four different heads, four different directions, praise God, and probably different purposes. Jesus said in the 7th chapter of the Gospel of John, right prior to his death, he said, if you would believe on me, as the scripture saith, out of your belly would flow rivers. That was plural. Rivers of living water. Now that's what this kind of an environment can do for you. Amen. You can take it from this immediate environment we have here in this church, and this is a good environment, by the way. The reason we feel like we feel here today is because people come with faith. People come with the good things of God. No, not perfect people, not people who don't make mistakes, but just people like you and me who love God, who are really trying to live for him, who are really trying to do it his way. When we come together and we have this collectiveness and this togetherness, praise God, there's something that can happen in an environment like this, amen, that can begin to burst forth things, praise God. That's what it's talking about. And this is why the Spirit is so very important. It's because a lot of what people are trying to do today for the kingdom of God is not connecting with the Spirit. And this is what makes it so difficult and so short-lived. See, the Spirit of God doesn't have the weaknesses and the cycles that you and I have. The Spirit of God is constant. God doesn't wake up on the wrong side of the bed. He doesn't have good days and bad days. The God that you and I serve is constant, praise God. That's why you and I can rely on him. Isn't that a good thing? It is absolutely a great thing, praise God. Amen. I've always said it, that a good idea becomes a great idea when people are ready, praise God. And if you're ready to receive the things of God, they're here and they are available for you. And you must understand, please, I can't emphasize this enough because God isn't taking me off of this thought. Somebody's need to hear this. You didn't bring anything into this. This isn't because of you. This has nothing to do with how great you are, what your backgrounds are, you know? You know, this has to do with him. God created this environment for Adam. God created these things for him. And just like today, God is creating environments for us to dwell in. Even in the world that we live in that's, you know, so much on a, it seems like on a tangent to reject the things of God, we can still sense and we can feel the environment of God in Jesus' name. Do you want that to grow in your life? Come on, I believe that you do. You know, you can just lift that hand right now and you can ask him. The Bible says, ask and you shall receive. Seek and you shall find. It's just that simple. God is good. Hallelujah. What an awesome God that we serve. What an awesome God. I can't say that enough. What an awesome God that we serve. What an awesome God that we serve. Praise God. Amen. But here's what I want you to see also. I mean, I'm just kind of meandering through this, but I feel like this is important because the Lord put it on my heart in the prayer room, and that's usually how it works for me. And so words in the Bible and words in different languages mean so much. You know, today in our language, you know, we've seen so much come and go, you know, even as a 60-some-year-old, you know, I've seen words that don't mean that anymore. You know, they used to mean those kind of things. And so I'm not being critical of our language, but it's a challenge, you know, today because we even make up things. In fact, there's even languages of slang where people will take languages and kind of slant it to their own thing. And that's why a study of God's word in the original languages is very, very valuable to you. You should do that. Doesn't mean that you become an expert or you know, fluent in that language, but you begin to go back to what is the true meaning of these words. What does that really mean? What did God mean when he was going to do that? I remember the other day, and I might do a teaching on it, the names that David gave to his children and the different times that those children were born really have significance. That he wasn't just naming them with a popular name. He wasn't just looking online to see what is the, you know, what's the popular name today that I should name my child. No, those names were named with purpose because things were going on. And you want to know why? Because they didn't want to forget what was going on. They didn't want to forget what God has done. Amen. That's one of the reasons why you and I have to go through the scriptures on a regular basis, in my opinion, is because we have a tendency to forget the things of God. We have a tendency to forget. You know, I don't know how long you've had the baptism of the Holy Ghost, but I'm getting close to my 40-year anniversary. Now, that's not a long time in the kingdom of God, but, you know, sometimes I forget what it was like when I first got the Holy Ghost and the excitement that was there and the hang-ups that I didn't have yet. See, that's why we got to remember that God puts these things in the scripture so that you and I won't forget them. So that we can go back and we can do a review of what God is doing, praise God. And we can bring that back into the environment that he created for us. Because God is powerful. There are several scriptures in the Bible that stipulate the fact that God does not change. He's as constant as it gets. He's not getting his God degree. This isn't what he's doing. He isn't working his way to a PhD in Godiology. He's God, always has been, praise God. And that's what you and I can remember, that he's God. He knows what's going on, praise God. He's got this thing down. When he creates an environment, he plans on that environment thriving, praise God. And that's why I'm telling you, I don't care how bad the world gets. I don't care how dark it seems like out there. God has created an environment in his spirit, praise God, where things can thrive, praise God. Things can begin to thrive. I can recall Brother Mason being here Wednesday night, the missionary, and his labor over in that area of the world, you know, where there was a lot of suppression by the government, and there still is over there, you know. But I remember back in the 80s when Ronald Reagan challenged Mr. Gorbachev to tear that wall down. I'll never forget that speech. That was quite a bunch of words that he said. And what's neat about it is it did some good. They began to tear those walls down. But I remember the elders telling us about the stories of how our organization, the United Pentecostal Church International, had things going on in that area of the country, but it had to be extremely secretive. And I remember our former general superintendent telling the story of how when he went there, how he had to get into like 6 or 8 different cars. And they had to drive in one part of town, and then they get into another car, and then they drive to another part of town, and then they drive to another part of town. And this was all just to go to a service, because the secret agents over there were looking for Christians, and they were trying to squash. See, there's been movements that have been trying to squash the movement of God since the beginning of time. The head of that is, of course, the devil. That's exactly what he's been doing. And sometimes he will work in your individual life. Not himself. He's got all kinds of agents that will do that. But the purpose is to squash the move of God. But I'm here to tell you, my God doesn't change. It doesn't matter how powerful the devil thinks he is. My God is more powerful. Come on, he's more powerful than anything in life in the name of Jesus. I'm telling you, folks, this is what God will do for you. And that's why having faith in this environment and what God has created. The Bible says if any person be in Christ, they're a new creature. Come on, God doesn't, he doesn't take stuff and refurbish it. He makes everything new in the name of Jesus. That's what he does in this environment. That's why you can lift your hands and receive the baptism of the Holy Ghost, because it's not based upon what you bring. It's based upon what God brings. And he keeps bringing it, my friend. That's what he keeps doing. Oh, hallelujah. Can we lift our hands together and praise God? And one of the things that you will see very, very regular in the scriptures is you will see that one of the patterns that God brings into the environment is growth. Growth. Even when it was referring to Jesus Christ, you know, hundreds of years before he came into being in the book of Isaiah, it talks about the fact that unto us a child is born. God declared to us how it was going to happen. That he wasn't just going to appear on the earth one day, that he was going to be born into the world. Praise God. But it makes several statements. You know, it talks about who he is and that type of thing. But it makes reference to the fact that the government of his, or let me just get this real quick, because I don't want to misquote this. This is an important aspect of the kingdom of God. Look at Isaiah chapter number 9. And then we'll go back to the second chapter here. I won't leave you hanging here. The Bible says in Isaiah 9 and 6, it says, for unto us a child is born, unto us a child is given. Now we understand a child is small, just begins real small. And the government upon his shoulders, and it says, and his name shall be called Wonderful Counselor, the Mighty God, the Everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace. Beautiful. We understand that God manifested himself in the flesh. Can you say amen? But look at verse number 7. It says, and of the increase of his government and peace, there shall be no end. Oh, my goodness, my little pea brain mind has gone lots of places with that. I don't personally believe there's life in other planets right now. I don't care what the huddle people say and all that business. That's just my opinion. That's how I feel. But I feel like maybe one day there will be. That's what I feel. I feel because of the increase of his government, praise God, that even this earth is not going to be able to contain the things. Because you must understand that God's not only going to make a new earth, but he's going to make new heavens. Amen. And those heavens are going to be places where you and I can dwell. Now, I know I'm getting, whoa, I can see it by some of the eyes in you. Man, this guy's been reading too many, you've been watching too many Trek movies or whatever. I don't know, that's not got nothing to do with this. That's got nothing to do with this, folks. It's got to do with the fact that the increase of what God is doing is going to have no end. You and I have gotten in a lot of ways in the bottom realm. And that's why you can really, really understand. I remember years ago when I got hired at John Deere in Dubuque, it was the place to work. There were people out there that had absolutely, now this is back in the early 70s, you know, there were people that had master's degrees that worked at John Deere. There were people that had PhDs that worked at John Deere because they couldn't make as much money in their livelihood as they could at John Deere. And back then, it was the I Ching. It was the place to work. And I remember one time when they had a few hundred jobs were coming open, that they opened the phone lines to, and there were over 20-some thousand calls within just a few minutes. Everybody wanted to work there, you know. And this was before I actually came to the Lord. And I wanted to work there. And I'll never forget getting the call. You can come in for an interview. And I went in for an interview, and they hired me on the spot. Right there, they hired me. And the next day, I had to go in for my physical because, you know, they had to check everything out. But I'll never forget talking to the people who were doing those things. And they were just, they were going to hire hundreds of people at that point in time because their production. They went into a construction line of equipment, and it was really booming. And they needed the plant where in Dubuque there had just opened up. It was, or not just opened up, but it expanded, and it was like almost 3 miles long. Right along the river there. It was really cool. And I'll never forget getting in there and talking to these people and then having them say, are you glad to be working here? I said, oh, man, this is great, you know. And they said, well, you are very fortunate because you're one of the first that are going to be hired. And I thought to myself, I felt very privileged that day. Praise God. I was getting in on the ground floor. Praise God. Well, John Deere has come and gone. That plant that at one time employed close to 7,000 people at one time, maybe not quite, maybe between 6,000 and 7,000 people. Now that same plant only employs about 1,500 to 1,800 people. See, man decreases. John the Baptist already told us that. And whether you like it or not, you must decrease, but he is going to increase. That's why the kingdom of God is in an expansion mode. Aren't you glad that you're in the kingdom of God now? That you're in that place, praise God, that environment where you, not only your personal life, but the environment around you can expand, praise God. Yes, go back often to that excitement of being in the house of God. I'm glad when they said unto me, let's go to the house of God. What you're involved with right here, whether you understand it in its fullness or not, is the best thing going on this side of heaven. You couldn't get it any better. You couldn't have picked a better place to live. You couldn't have picked a better church to attend, praise God. I'm telling you that. I'm not bragging. I'm telling you because God has brought into this environment all the things that we need. Oh, hallelujah. And I have found in my limited experience, I found that people who can position themselves into a place where they can receive the things of God are the ones that do. It's got nothing to do with how talented they are or what kind of a background they have family-wise. It's just the idea that they position themselves on a regular basis to receive the things of God. Amen. And part of that word receive, if you study it in the Greek in the New Testament, is to accept. Accept what God is doing. This is what he's doing. Amen. Even though you don't understand it, even though you're wanting to have it figured out before you receive it, that's what you call getting the cart before the horse. I received the Holy Ghost years before I had any of it figured out. I had no idea what had just happened to me when I received the Holy Ghost. All I knew was I just needed to learn how to yield to God, and all of a sudden there came out of me, and I learned it as one of these rivers. What came out of me was something that was never there before. And like most of you, I tried to stop it, which became very silly. Why stop God? Let it begin to keep going. And I'm not talking about just speaking in other tongues. I'm talking about the ability to lay hands on the sick and they shall recover. I'm talking about prophetic gifts. I'm talking about the word of wisdom. I'm talking about the word of knowledge. All of these things come from the environment that God created. You and I don't deserve it. We didn't bring this. We didn't have any addition here. All we do is come in and become inhabitants. Praise God. Oh, I'm all over the map here, but I just feel such a tendency for somebody. Look at what it says in the book of Ephesians. Look at the book of Ephesians, and we are going to go back to Genesis. Look at somebody and say, he's going to go back. I am, because I got something really exciting to show you there in that second chapter. But I got to do this first. Look at Ephesians chapter number 2. Chapter number 2 in the book of Ephesians is an exciting book that teaches us how to live in the kingdom of God down here. It teaches us a lot about the environment that Jesus Christ created, amen, by coming to this earth. Now, look at what it says here. The Bible says in verse number 19, I've used this before, but it says, now therefore, in chapter 2, Ephesians 2 and 19, it says, now therefore you are no more strangers and foreigners, but fellow citizens with the saints and of the household of God. That's where we're at. It says, and are built upon the foundation of the apostles and prophets, Jesus Christ himself being the chief cornerstone. And then it goes on to say, in whom all the building fitly framed together, say that word with me. I like that word. It's designed to grow. Now, I think there's a few of you in here that I feel real led to stop right now and point out to you. That's what you're feeling. You're feeling some growing pains because you didn't have anything to do with this. This is God's kingdom. This is what he designed to do. And we're coming in as the Johnny-come-latelys, and we're trying to figure the whole thing out when we know this is God's environment. It's like Adam walking up to God and saying, are you sure you created this right? You sure you planted that tree in the right place? Oh, it's, as ridiculous as that seems, that's exactly what some of you are doing. You're going up to God and saying, what do you mean speak in tongues? What do you mean clap my hands? What do you mean praise you with my voice? You see what I'm saying? I just used a very simple illustration. We would never have thought about going up to God after he created the Garden of Eden saying, you created this wrong. And yet, some of us in the spiritual environment, that's exactly what we do. Now, God being a kind and a very merciful and loving God, he doesn't hold that against us. But he does expect you to begin to grow in the kingdom. Because the Bible says, in whom all the building fitly framed together groweth into an holy temple in the Lord, in whom you also are builded together. And look what it says. For an habitation. A habitation of what? A habitation of God through the Spirit. That's what he's designed. No, there's not a physical Garden of Eden here in this world right now. But there's a spiritual one. And this is what God has designed for us to grow in. This is where God designs us to be. And that's why sometimes we hesitate, sometimes we doubt, sometimes we struggle. Well, in my opinion, I'm not trying to condone or be mean, but I call them growing pains. I've had a lot of them in the last 40 years. I wasn't raised in this kind of a environment. I just happened to come into it one day and recognize that there was something powerful happening here. Now, in my opinion, I feel like the same thing happens every day. Oh, I know what I was going to tell you about Eastern Europe. You know, is the fact that they talk about the fact that the church was underground over there because of that ungodly government. And ungodly governments are not a new thing, folks. There's been governments all over. Our government was very, very close to becoming one of those. And I don't know if it might still be. I don't know. I'm not down on America, folks. Please, podcast, not down on America. But what I'm saying is when you reject God and you start going another direction, you start suppressing the things of the Lord. But as the Eastern or Western Europe learned, when that wall came down, what we discovered as an organization is that there were thriving churches that were existing even in that ungodly environment. They found one church in particular that had over 50,000 members. Now, I'm talking about during years where the government didn't want them to do that. I'm telling you, folks, his environment, what God has created, will thrive. And you don't have to worry about it. All you have to do is enter into it and just receive what God has. Oh, yeah, there's responsibility. Because if you study, you know, the reason that Adam was put in there, he was put in there to work. He was put in there to take care of what God had already created. So don't give me this stuff that we don't have to do anything. No, there's things that God will put in our ability chamber. But the bottom line is he brought all of that into that environment already. We don't supply that. We are supplied via his Spirit. And this is what you and I have to go back over and over and over and remember that we didn't bring anything into this. God brought it all to us. I remember being a product of divorce, and I hope that doesn't make anybody uncomfortable here. It's not intended to be, but I am a product of divorce. I got married when I was 19 years old. It wasn't the smartest thing I ever did. And 2 years later, I found myself with a small little girl and a single parent. And I'm not rubbing anybody's face in anything. That was the environment I came from. Disappointment. All of a sudden, I was thrust into parenthood, and I had no clue. I'll never forget one of the biggest pieces of advice I got from my own mom. The day I went to court and I got custody of my little girl, and I didn't do that to get back at my ex-wife, folks. I did it because I really feel at that time God laid that on my heart. And it never happened before in the city of Cascade. I was one of the first. They had never given custody to a man before back in the early 70s, folks. That didn't happen. That's the first thing my lawyer told me. He said, this is going to cost you a lot of money and you probably won't win. How would you like to get that kind of advice? That's exactly what he told me. But there was something God was working in me even back then. And I'll never forget coming out of that courtroom where the judge, he saw it. I didn't. But he saw it. He said, well, that guy's going to be a whole lot better parent than her. And he said, I'm giving it to her and to him. And I was like, whoa. And I'll never forget my mom coming out the front door of the courthouse there in Dubuque County. And she looked at me and she said, I want you to remember one thing. And you know, when my mom, 4'11", she points her finger at you, that's just, you better listen. I didn't always give heed to her, but man, I listened to her. And she said, listen, I want you to remember that he gave you custody. And my mom is not intentionally mean. Although sometimes it can seem that way. She's pretty abrupt. She was 10 years old when her dad died, and she had an upbringing that was pretty tough in the world. And she doesn't make any bones about it, but it made her who she was. And so she was reminding me that now you have responsibility. And so here I am. That's how I came into the church, folks. I was a single parent. Most of you wouldn't give me the time of day because that still had a stigma on it back then. Yeah. I know I've learned a lot, and God has helped me to process a lot of things through the environment that I came out of. But God took that environment. He took that no good. He took that, what is he going to do? And he put me in an environment with people like you. And I'm going to tell you, it wasn't that my world became perfect, but the idea of it is, praise God, God gave me all the help that I needed. He was there all the time. This is what I want to try to tell somebody right now. Your outside environment might look pretty bad, but I'm telling you, inside here, God can do anything. He can bring relationships back together. He can cause us to forgive when we never had any intentions of forgiving. He can cleanse our hearts on a regular basis and give us a vessel that can be filled with his glory. I'm telling you, that's what God can do in this environment, praise God. And that's what he wants to do. That's what he wants to do. But we still do it. We still look sideways when somebody comes in and looks like that and has had a bad deal in life. We do. And I'm not blaming anybody. I'm just saying we got to quickly get over that. And we got to remember what God has done for us. And we didn't do anything to deserve this. We didn't bring anything into this picture. He brought it all. And all we got to do is position ourselves to receive from God. Come on, somebody here, you need to get this. Come on, quit using this as a stumbling block. And just lift those hands in true submission and receive the things of God. Come on, it's got to be that simple. It's gotta be that simple, or every one of us would miss it. Every one of us would, because we can write our own little edge on this. We can, and most of the time we do. And this is what God wants to help us with, Because he's created a spiritual environment down here, folks, with I don't care how rocking and rolling that Antichrist gets. The Bible says the gates of hell shall not prevail against the church that God's building. I'm telling you right now, God's got a powerful church. He's got an army that's marching through the land. He's got people that aren't afraid to tell folks about what the kingdom of God is all about. I'm telling you, this is what you're involved in the name of Jesus. Come on, it's not some political thing. It's got to do with the creation. When God came down to this earth the first time and it was a mess, he created. He didn't do away with it. Come on, study the chronological order yourself. He didn't throw away the earth. He just came down and said, okay, it's a mess, but I'm going to create something that isn't a mess. And he began to systematically, come on, study the first chapter of the book of Genesis. And he systematically began to set an environment where people could get involved in the kingdom of God, praise God. That's what God did. And that's why he isn't down here to debate about where you came from and how bad things are. He's here to create something in you that is for his glory in the name of Jesus. That's what God is doing. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And you know, some dummies like me, we can learn. We can learn. Back, you know, BC, man, I went out looking for, you know, things that I shouldn't have been looking for, but I was. You know? But I got myself in an old-fashioned little church up there on Marywood and Chrissy, and lo and behold, about 2.5 years after I got in the church, God brings this blonde to me. She'd been in the church for a year and a half, probably almost 2 years. She had a boyfriend. That's what the deal was. But no, and I thought they made a great couple. I still do. I mean, they were both tall, and I thought, man, they're going to get married, but it wasn't in the plan of God for him. So he just said I didn't want to, you know, get that serious with her. And I kind of be careful what I'm sharing here, you know. But the bottom line is I was in the environment. I didn't have to go out there looking. God knew exactly what I needed. He knew the countermeasures that needed to be put in my life. And God led it to me. Listen to me, folks. That was an important experience for me, because a lot of times that has eliminated a lot of problems in my life. I used it just 4 months ago. 28 years working for Haggerty's. And all I get is a phone call on a Thursday afternoon saying, at the end of the month, we're out of here. It wasn't quite that bad. But I just wanted you to think it was. No, I'm just. But it was abrupt. And so what am I going to do? My goodness, you know, you go home and you think, well, I guess we're going to Australia or something. I don't know. Well, you know, you know how your mind works. But that didn't last long, because I've been in this long enough. I said, God knows what I'm going to do. And so what I did was, a lot of times, and this is what's worked for me, and I think it'll work for you too, is I just said, I'm going to keep doing what I have already been doing. And I did it again Saturday. I fixed a flute. I fixed a contrabass clarinet. I just kept doing the things that I know I should do. Now, that's the natural world. Why don't we take that to the spiritual world? Why don't you come to church sometimes? Why don't you read your Bible sometimes? Why aren't you praying like you know you should? Now, I'm not reprimanding. I'm just asking the question. God just says, keep doing the things that you know to do. And this is what will help you to stay not only in the kingdom of God, but to be there when the real blessings of God begin to flow. Because they will, folks. They will. Now, let me show you how. Let's go back to the second chapter of the book of Genesis. And again, we started this thing with talking about environment that God creates, and he does. And that's why I love these first three chapters of the book of Genesis, because they explain so much to me. They really do. That God can make anything out of anything. And that's exactly what he did. But he will trouble the waters. He will bring some things into the picture that will make us go, whoa, I better get a hold of something that's a little bit more powerful than me. And that's another thing that you sense in your life right now, is that you sense that I better stay with Jesus. And that isn't a threat, by the way. That's just the way God designed his kingdom to work. It doesn't work anyplace else but in his environment. And so the Bible says, and a river went out of Eden. That's verse 10, Brother Jeremy, 2 and 10. And it says to water the garden. There was a purpose for that, because that garden needed a supply of water to maintain growth. And you and I, we need the same thing. And the Bible says, and from thence it was parted and became into four heads. And the name of the first is Pison. Now again, I told you before, these names have meanings. And the word Pison literally means increase. That's what it means in the Hebrew. And so you see what the design of God is. That his design is not for something to remain small. I got it again this morning while I was circling this church. You know, my little thing I do, I go pray around the church, and it's not because I don't have anything better to do. It's because God has told me to do that, and that's what I do, you know. But I come around one corner, and all of a sudden, I caught a glimpse of a vision of a bigger church in Gillette. Just caught a glimpse. And all of a sudden, I just thought, whoa, yeah, it's going to increase. I thought about that Wednesday night, you know, when we had this altar call, and hardly anybody could get down here because we don't have much room. And God's aware of that. I don't know how he's going to do it, folks, but I know he is. Just like his kingdom is increasing, the church in Gillette is going to increase. I don't care how many people leave. I know he's going to add people to come. And that's just how it works. Now, that's what he'll show you when you're just in his environment. He'll show you things like that. Now, he didn't tell me when. He didn't give me an address. He didn't say, you know, go over and lay your hands on this building one time. You know, no, he just said it's going to happen. And so that's the kingdom of God. And I believe it has to do with that water, living water, increase. There's always an increase in the kingdom of God. And that's why I'm going to maintain that I'm going to be a studier. I'm going to be a student. I'm going to keep doing this stuff. I don't care how bad my eyesight gets or whatever my hearing gets. I'm going to keep studying the Word of God because I want it to increase in me. Can somebody say amen? I pray the spirit of increase in your life. Amen. The reason why some of you got bigger problems is because you've allowed certain things to increase in your life. Maybe you got a bigger lust now than you used to have. Maybe you got a bigger desire to want you know, the things of this world. I'm not condoning, condemning, I'm just telling you. What I have to do is I got to squash that stuff because I get the same things. There's times when I'd like to have a few grand in the bank. There's times when I would like to have this and have that. Come on, folks, I'm human. Don't cut it, but if you do, it'll be red blood. And so what has to happen? I've got to put that stuff down on a regular basis. I got to put it in the back burner. I got to put the things of God in the front burner. Man, this week I'm heading to St. Louis tomorrow, and I got to go to meetings for 3 days, and then I got to come back here and work in my shop for a day and try to get caught up. And then I got to go all the way up to Montana for more meetings for another day and a half. That's exhausting. Do I want to do that? No. But I do it because I love God. And I'm not complaining. I'm just telling you, you got to make a lot of room for God if you really want his increase in your life. That's what happens. There's a lot of folks out here sitting right under the sound of my voice. You got talent. You got 5 times the talent that I have. You've got abilities, praise God, that I'm not even going to have time to get. But you just got too many other things going on. You got too many other things. And again, you're going to have to sort that out. But please, please keep coming to the kingdom of God, because the world is only going to increase it to you. The world is only going to tell you that you can get another loan, or you can do this, or you can do that. You come into the kingdom of God, I'll tell you something. He's got a way of trimming the fat. He's got a way of saying, listen, if you just lay that down, I'll give you something a whole lot better. This is the way it's been for the last 40 years for me, folks. And I'm nobody. I'm not somebody special. I'm not. I'm just some kid that just ended up in an apostolic church. Because I didn't even know what I wanted. And then God still gave me the opportunity to reject it. Wow, that's real trust. When God doesn't, once you get in the door, he doesn't slam it and throw away the key. And this is how we approach it sometimes. That's not how it works in the kingdom of God. That back door will always be open. You're the one that's going to have to lock it and throw away the key. And you can do that in Jesus' name. Everybody say Pison. That was the first head that came out of that river. Now, this is the river that was on this earth, praise God. And the Bible says that it which compasseth the whole land of Havilah, where there is gold. And we're not talking about physical gold now. We're talking about faith that in God's eyes is precious gold. That's why you must have the increase of the gold of God in your life. You can't let your measure of faith stay small. You've got to let that measure of faith begin to grow. That's what it says in Romans 12. What I was going to really teach on today is I was going to teach on the seven steps of faith. That's what I was going to do, because there's steps that you can take that you can begin to secure what God has put in you, praise God. And it'll get you through anything and everything, praise God. But that first head was increase. God says you're going to need more. And not more of what the world gives you, but more of what I got to give to you. Can you say amen? And then the Bible says, and the name of the second is Gihon. And what that means, literally, that means bursting. You ever got yourself to a place in a prayer meeting sometime where all of a sudden just something kind of burst out of you? It was just spontaneous. Listen, some of you need to get back to that kind of simple childlike faith. You're too reserved. You're waiting for some sledgehammer to come down on the back of your head before you're going to move. Why don't you let the bursting power of God go? I'm telling you, this would help somebody that needs to get the Holy Ghost. It's in you already. God created the environment. Let it burst forth. Well, I'm afraid what they're going to think. Who cares what anybody thinks? God created it. It's what He wants. That's why I believe in the spontaneity of the Word. I believe in the spontaneity of praise, just like what you're doing right now. You're proving it. Oh, you're just trying to jig those people up. No, I'm not. I'm just trying to get something to burst forth. And that's what that second river was. It was something that could burst forth. Streams of living water. It wasn't Jacob's well. Come on, study Jacob's well. It was just a hole in the ground that depended on water to come from, you know, to drain in there. That's why they couldn't drink it. They had to take it home and boil it. And Jesus told the lady that was at the well, I can do better than that. Come on, this is what God wants to do. He wants to bring the increase, and then there's times when He wants to birth forth, praise God, something that is only from His kingdom. And that's what He will do. That's why it's not emotion, folks. It's faith. We've thought it was emotion. If I get, oh, then all of a sudden, no, that might work for a time or two, but you got to let faith begin to increase in your life, and then when God, not if, when God begins to put something in you, it might be a bursting forth during a witnessing time. It might be a bursting forth when God says, go lay hands on that person and pray for them. I'm telling you, it could do a lot of things. Amen. But God created it for us. That's why you don't bring it into the picture. It's not something you went to school to learn. It's something that you receive in the kingdom of God. And this is where the apostolic movement, in my opinion, in some places have gone wrong. They think we can bring people into institutions and teach them things. Yes, we can teach them some things, but there are some things that have already been created, and all we got to do is have enough faith to let them move through us. I'm not doing away with our higher learning institutes. I love them. I think they're great. But I'm here to tell you, folks, we're losing what the creation brought into the picture. And God brought in the ability for us to grow. He brought in the ability for us to move past our flesh sometimes and just let it all go. Praise God. But He isn't finished there. The Bible says, in the name of the third river is Hiddekel, that is, it which goeth toward the east of Assyria. And that word literally means rapid. It means it's going to get going fast. I can't think of what chapter it is in the book of Ezekiel. I think it's in the 40s, though. But it talks about the fact that Ezekiel saw a vision. And the vision had to do with water coming out of the temple. And that temple, that water came to the ankle. And then all of a sudden it moved to the knees. And then pretty soon it got up to the midsection. And it didn't stop there. It got to a place where he was literally swimming in it. This is what God wants to do. This is the natural progression of God. If you think you're going to play it safe and really get a substantial growth in God, you and I are fooling ourselves. We've got to wade out there, praise God, where the water is a little bit deeper than we can handle. But God is there. He will help us. It's like He told Peter, you want to see how this works? C-O-M-E. That's what He told Peter. Come. And Jesus has said that a lot in our King James Version Bible. Come unto me, all ye that are heavy laden and labor, and I will give you rest. It's like I got a problem today supplying what you need. Come on, folks. That's not what God created. He created the ability with seed. Amen. And one of the greatest lessons he ever gave us was the seed is the word. And so this is what he does. He wants to increase this into our lives. And we're living in an environment and a world that wants to always decrease it. I'm superintendent, so I got to deal with pastors, and I love these guys. They're great guys. They're doing the best that they can. But I don't like this idea that they're eliminating services. You do with that what you want. I don't think that's the will of God. Something's the matter here. Well, not everybody's going to come, but that's the excuse I get. Well, so? And? Well, we'll shut down tonight's service because probably half of these people won't come. So, no. We're going to keep doing it. See, folks, that's the kingdom of God, is you find out what he wants you to do, and you keep doing it. You don't take the lie of the world to say, hey, we got this going, we got this practice, and we got this going. I know I'm making some people uncomfortable, but I can't help it. You're the ones that make it uncomfortable for yourselves. If you start eliminating some things in your life that you know you really don't need, you'll have plenty of room for God. It's just the way it is all the way around, folks. And then the Bible says, and it says, and the fourth river was Euphrates. And isn't it kind of cool that one's still over there, isn't it? Tigris and Euphrates. And you know what the word Euphrates means? Fruitfulness. God's designed for us to increase. He's designed for us, you know, to have a bursting forth. He's designed for us sometimes to get going a lot faster than we do. You know, one case in point there was Elijah. Remember him? The guy in the First Kings where he was dealing with all of these false prophets? Well, God, through that one man, eliminated 850 of them just like that. That's hard for me to fathom. He killed 850 people. One, you know, I don't know if it was a whole day. I think it had to be. But bottom line is he did it. But God, to show himself, the hand of the Lord came upon that man. And Ahab, who was really the problem, he went ahead of him to Jezreel, which was about 20 miles away. And Elijah's up there on the mountain, and he doesn't have a chariot. He doesn't even have a Mini Cooper. I mean, this guy doesn't have anything. But the hand of the Lord came on him, and he girded himself up, and through the hand of the Lord, he was able to beat Ahab back to that city. That's what we got to get back to, that real simple, like, if I'm in the kingdom, God will supply. I'm telling you, folks, it's in the spirit. That's what it is. I know I have fed some tremendously starving people here today. That is exactly what I have felt here today. And you're not bad people, you're good people. I told you that last Sunday, and I'll let you know, the problem isn't with you. No. You just got yourself hooked up to a world that sometimes can lead you down the wrong road. Come on, I'm not saying that you can't bring some problems into the situation, but God doesn't look at you as a problem child. He doesn't look at you as somebody that really needs this, you know, 20 years of counseling before we can even get you out of the institution type of mentality. Come on, folks. I'm telling you, you let the Holy Ghost begin to work its work in you, and you can take somebody that the world would have just literally thrown away, and within weeks, praise God, they can become somebody that is increasing, that is bursting forth, that is moving faster than anybody else did that had been in the church for 30 years, and then they're going to begin to become fruitful in their lives. I'm telling you why, because it's the river that God has created, and Jesus gave us that prophecy in the New Testament when he said, if you'll believe on me, as the Scripture saith, out of your bellies shall flow rivers of living water. And this he spake of the Spirit. This is what he was talking about. He clarified it. He told us exactly what was going on. Come on, don't hesitate. If you feel that hunger in your heart right now, why don't you go ahead and stand and put both of those hands up and begin to make those requests known unto God. Don't wait for me to do something for you. Come on, I preached the word. That's what I did. Come on, this is between you and God. You don't have to sit there and think he's going to hide from you. He isn't. He hasn't hid from anybody. It's right here, right now, in the name. name of Jesus. I'm telling you, folks, the increase, the bursting forth, the rapidness, the fruitfulness, it's all right here. It's in His creation. He did it, praise God. Oh, hallelujah. Hallelujah. Oh, I bless the Lord. Oh, my soul, all that is within me. Come on, somebody needs to lay down some ambitions. Somebody here needs to lay down some fleshly desires. You can do that in this environment right now. You can lay them down. You can say, God, I know that that's not right. You're going to lead something into my life, and I want to be ready. I want to be ready for your kingdom. Oh, hallelujah, hallelujah. That's it, I'm telling you. Right now, there's a few of you. There's at least two or three of you in here right now. You spoke in tongues. You got the Holy Ghost, but you've let it sit idle for too long. Come on, there needs to be something coming out of you. If not today, real soon, in the name of Jesus. Come on, don't let it lay dormant any longer. Come on, don't lay it down and pick up something that really isn't got any value at all. Come on, that's what God wants us to do. He gave us the Holy Ghost. He allowed us to be baptized in Jesus' name for the remission of all of our sins. Come on, He created a plan where you and I, we could come into His environment. We could come into His kingdom. Come on, I'm telling you, Jesus said you must be born again or you're not going to see the kingdom of God. You must be born of the water and of the Spirit or you're not going to enter into the kingdom of God. But He's given us that. He's given us that resource, folks. He's given us that resource in the name of Jesus. That's it, I'm telling you. That's it. Let that hunger be satisfied. Let that hunger be satisfied. Oh, in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. Let that hunger be satisfied. Oh, hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. Jesus, I'm so glad. I'm so glad that your environment is true. I'm so glad that your environment is true. Oh, hallelujah. Come on, there's some starving people here that are getting some tremendous nourishment. You're getting some tremendous nourishment right now. I'm telling you, I don't have it all figured out, but I know that's the way it works in the kingdom of God. The hungry and the thirsty, blessed. Blessed are the hunger, people who hunger after righteousness. Oh, hallelujah. The Bible says they shall be filled. They shall be. Come on, that's the kingdom of God. That's how it operates in the name of Jesus. Oh, hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. Oh, hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. Oh, the kingdom of God. The kingdom of God. The kingdom of God. Come on, let's just tarry a few more minutes now. Come on. Come on. If you struggle with this, you can sit down and just close your eyes if you want. I'm not here to intimidate you. But as long as there's hungry and thirsty people, I believe they can be satisfied in the name of Jesus. Oh, hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. That's it. Come on, there's some daughter works that need to be established in this area. And there are some preachers in this room right now where God is getting you ready for that kind of a commitment. In the name of Jesus. Come on, there's some small groups that need to be taught. And He's getting teachers ready right here. That's what an environment like this will do. It will get people ready for the increase. It'll get people ready for the increase. Oh, hallelujah, Jesus. Oh, hallelujah. Oh, hallelujah, Jesus. Oh, my goodness. Yes, in the name of Jesus. Oh, hallelujah. That's it, Lord. Trim away all the fat. Get rid of the excess. Get rid of the things, the burdens that are weighing us down, Lord God. Oh, Jesus. Oh, hallelujah, Jesus. Let your kingdom, Lord God, come. Oh, thy will be done. On this earth as it is in heaven. Oh, hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. Continue to pray, folks. It's here in Jesus' name. The splendor of King. Clothed in majesty. Let all the earth rejoice. all the earth to rejoice. He wraps himself in light. Oh, and darkness tries to hide. It trembles at his voice, trembles at his voice. How great is our God. Sing it with me, how great is our God. And all the earth will sing, how great is our God. Oh, how great is our God. Sing it with me, how great is our God. And all will see how great, how great. In his hands, the beginning and the end, beginning and the end. Oh, the Lord our God is one. Thank you, Jesus, Father, Spirit, Son. He's the Lion and the Lamb, Lion and the Lamb. Oh, how great is our God. Sing it with me, how great is our God. And all will see how great is our God. Oh, how great is our God. Sing it with me, how great is our God. And all will see how great is our God. Oh, his name above all names, worthy of all praise. Will sing how great is our God. Oh, his name above all names, worthy of all praise. Oh, my heart will sing. Is an awesome God. He reigns from heaven above with wisdom, power, and love. Our God is an awesome God. Our God is an awesome God. He reigns from heaven above with wisdom, power, and love. Our God is an awesome God. Our God once again is an awesome God. He reigns from heaven above with wisdom, power, and love. Our God is an awesome God. Our God, oh, is an awesome God. He reigns from above with wisdom, power, and love. Our God is an awesome God. One more time. Our God is an awesome God. He reigns from heaven above with wisdom, wisdom, power, and love. Our God is an awesome God. Oh, hallelujah. Hallelujah. Heavenly Father, in the name of Jesus, I pray that that anointing will get upon every person in this place, and that that reality of who He is will sink in deeper than it ever has sought, in the name of Jesus. And I give You the praise and I give You the glory in Jesus' name, in Jesus' name. Let's thank the Lord together. Can we do that? Hallelujah.
Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. The Lord bless you, folks. Again, tonight we'll be meeting. We've got various things going on Sundays here. But tonight we will be meeting again here, and you're sure welcome to come. And the prayer room will be open somewhere after the 5 o'clock hour. And so come and let the kingdom of God begin to work in you the things that God really designed for you to have. And the Lord bless you. Tithes and offerings, as most of you know, go into the things that are at by the doors there. The Lord bless each and every one of you in Jesus' name. Thanks for coming.